Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Happy Easter. He is risen. Yeah. Amen. Okay, it's great to see everybody here today. We're going to start this morning's service with a Bible reading. Today's Bible reading is going to be from Luke 24, verses 1 to 49, and it's going to be up on the screen if you'd like to follow along. So take a seat. So it's Jesus has risen. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of the sinners, be crucified on the third day, and be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to be like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. Now that same day, two of them were going to the village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with him, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that this was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early in the morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while we talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together, and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written, the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high."
Amen. Amen. Why don't you stand this morning? Sing praises to our Most High God. Jesus Christ is risen today. Amen.
shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross.
You lay
down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for you've done for me.
Yes, God, we will sing of all that you've done.
Who brings that chaos? Who brings that chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice. Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Yes, he is.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
Good morning. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Grab a seat and say hello to the person beside you and say something wonderful about the fact that he's alive. He's not dead. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? some wonderful promises that the Lord has given us. I read a quote this week, and it's simply this: the first tree gave us sin, shame, and brokenness, but the second tree gave us forgiveness, love, and freedom. How true that is, yeah? Praise God. Praise God. My name's Jeremy. I'm part of the team here at Gateway. If you're visiting, I do see some visitors this morning. We'd just like to welcome you and thank you for coming as we worship our great God, particularly on this day. So symbolic, the fact that Christ was raised from the dead and that all changes because of that. Let me just read you a passage from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 to 19. It says this: "But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection from the dead? If there is no resurrection from the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead, but he did not raise him if, in fact, the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins." Praise God, it's not futile. "Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied." It's a wonderful thing, and I trust that you've come to know that reality, the power of God already in your own heart and in your own life as we bear witness to what God has done. And if not, I trust that this is the day where your eyes and hearts are open, similar to the disciples walking on the road to Emmaus. Just for in the life of the church, just with what's happening, given a welcome, but again, another welcome to those who are visiting. There are free hot cross buns after the service in the cafe. They have some nice butter on it. They'll just go down. For those people finishing the fast, all right, you'll just enjoy yourself right there. Neil Ryan is preaching today. Neil, you should say something good today, I'm sure. Connect groups resume in week one of the school term, so another week off there. If you're not connected, you're more than welcome to be part of those different groups. Joel Hammond is speaking next Sunday, so we look forward to hearing from Joel and what God has to say through Joel. And last week, just for those of us who are connected at Gateway, Roy and Sue Anderson left for the Philippines, doing some great work over there, and I did say that I'd pray for them this week. So let's pray for them as they go about God's work over there in the Philippines. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what you've done. We thank you that we have hope. We thank you that we have life. We thank you that we have forgiveness of sins. And Father, we just thank you for the call that's been on Roy and Sue and the team of Destiny, for what they've done and what they're doing over in the Philippines, to see people fed, to see people housed, to see children and all ages coming to faith. And so, Lord, we ask for a blessing to be upon them. Father, not just them, but everyone who calls on the name of the Lord. We thank you for faith, and we just pray that faith might open doors for all of us in taking the reality of what you've done into our everyday lives. And we just pray for them, especially this day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. For those of us who are worshiping, our next slide there, Brenton. Offering. We give because God gave to us. As you can see there, the chicken says to the pig, "Hey, we should open a restaurant." And he goes, "I'm not sure, what could we call it?" And she, the chicken, says, "Ham and cheese." And he freaks out. He goes, "No thanks, I'd be committed and you'd only be involved." Aren't you glad that Jesus was more than involved? Anyone can get involved. He was committed to the cross. He's committed to us 2,000 years ago, and he's still committed to us today. And we give because God's given. And if you've made a commitment to Jesus, and if you want to see his name be made famous, an opportunity before us now is to give, and give generously, give sacrificially to make his name famous and to proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes. So the ushers can come and enjoy this clip. It's all possible because of what Christ has done.
Amazing.
place. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace.
Thank you for the offering that has been given. Lord, we pray that you would bless it and multiply it. Lord, thank you for the giving hearts of people here in this place and in this church. Lord, because we just reflect you. We reflect the life that you gave because you are giving. That is what you do. That is who you are. And Lord, we just pray that we'll continue to do that. So Lord, we just pray that you would bless the offering that has been received this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't you stand again this morning? I'm going to continue to worship God.
chains we're free. By his blood we're washed clean. Now we have the victory. The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all. He has won our freedom. Jesus has won it all. And hallelujah, you have won. seated in majesty.
Song.
Jesus, and you are alive. You've overcome hell and death, every sickness, every circumstance. You have overcome it, and we are victorious in you, Lord. We rise with you because you live in us. We give you all the glory and the praise. Lord, as your word comes this morning, I pray that you would bless it. Pray, Lord, we would receive it. Because your word is powerful. It is your word is the foretold word that raised you from the dead. So this morning we pray, rise us up out of our situation, out of our circumstances. Rise us up from ourselves. Alive in us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So welcome, Neil. And the kids can go out to Sunday school.
That one. That'll be great. Thank you. Morning, everyone. I didn't hear you that. Morning, everyone. Oh, that's better. That's better. Thank you again, Andrew, and all the team who have disappeared so quickly. Can you just thank our band? Wasn't that wonderful worship? It was just such Christ-honouring worship. It's just wonderful, and we just appreciate it so much. Man, I love Jeremy. I keep saying this all the time. We've got this bit of a man love thing going on, but it might surprise you that Jeremy and I come from different generations. Did you pick that up? just saying. But I found another one this morning where, I mean, we think the same in a lot of things, but we're very different kind of blokes. I'll tell you why. In my generation, if you wear a coat, you put the shirt in, right? In Jeremy's generation, you wear a coat that's hanging out. I love it. I reckon it looks scrappy, but it's all right. He's gone out now, so it doesn't matter. But I love him, and I'm going to keep saying it. I just hope you cherish what you've got, because he is He's a wonderful man. He's a great man of God. I love the way he loves Jesus, and I love the way he loves you. And everything he does is for Jesus and for you. The hard things, the easy things, and everything in the middle. Had a good start to the day today. I had to share with a group of people down at Brighton at 6 o'clock. And you know what was the best thing about this morning at 6 o'clock down at Brighton? Here we were, a group of Christians, and I'm all geared up to speak to them. And you know what happened? It poured. It rained on us. And I'm thinking, you little beauty. Do you know why I think that? It's because the resurrection is not some little fairy tale that we think, you know what, when we go down the beach on Good Sunday morning, it's going to be this beautiful sunrise, just like a big fairy tale. And I'm thinking, God, when it rains, Jesus is alive. When it's sunshine, Jesus is alive. Listen, I know this morning, I don't have to ask you, it's raining on some of you at the moment. Jesus is alive. Some of you, the sun's shining. Jesus is alive. I hope you know that this morning. Let's forget the fairy tale. The reason the resurrection is so powerful is because he is alive. And it kind of got me during the week. I don't know if you remember, but the first time I preached down here was this time last year on Easter Sunday. And here we are again on Easter Sunday. And I started to think during the week, what are we supposed to do on Easter Sunday? I mean, this day is the game changer, isn't it? This is the day of all days. This is the one that changed human history. So how do you and I deal with that? How do we deal with resurrection? I'll let you into a little secret. When the alarm went off at 5 o'clock this morning, it didn't feel like the resurrection. I thought, oh no, it's on again. So what? Look, we sing these beautiful songs. We greet each other and we say, Happy Easter, he's risen. And we go, he's risen indeed. But what is going on? What are we supposed to do with this? Yeah, I don't know if anybody's been to Jerusalem, but if you get to go to Jerusalem on the other side of the Kidron Valley, right by the Garden of Gethsemane at the foot of the Mount of Olives, is this building that's called the Church of All Nations. And it's a church that's built over the place where Jesus would have kneeled and prayed that agonizing prayer. God, if it's possible to take this cup away from me, but nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And then the soldiers came. You know the interesting part about that church? Is that as you walk into it, there's a big sign by the door, and the sign says this: no explanations inside the church. I love that. You know, everywhere you go in Jerusalem, you go into these churches and artifacts, and everywhere you hear this cacophony of noise as tourist guides try and explain what happened in this place. This church says no explanation. Just be there. You know what? It struck me during the week. That's not a bad advice for Easter. No explanation. Today we don't come to prove the resurrection, we come to proclaim it. How different is that? We don't need to be convinced of the resurrection, we need to be confronted by it. In other words, you don't need me to stand here today and try and explain how it was possible. You need me to say it's happened and God wants to invade your life because of that. You know the problem with explanations? Is that when you try and explain something, I know we need to do it, and by the way, before I go on, Christianity welcomes questions. It welcomes doubts. It welcomes cynics. And if you're here this morning and you're a cynic, we're glad you're here. But I'm not going to answer your questions this morning, not today. Because today's a proclamation day. It's a day when we don't need to convince you, we need to be confronted by the resurrection. And when you try and explain things, you can tame them. For instance, I can give you a definition of love. I looked it up this morning, so it's straight out of the dictionary. Do you know what it says? Love is an intense feeling of deep affection. Try that one, fellas. Go home today and say to your wife, I have an intense feeling of deep affection for you. See if that does it. See if she just falls over and says, man, I've been waiting to hear that for years. See what happens when you try and explain love? It kind of tames it and it sort of puts it into some legislative form, and you can't tame love, can you? Paul said that there's faith and hope, but the greatest is love, because you can't tame it. Listen, I don't want to tame the resurrection. Do you understand what I'm trying to say here this morning? I don't want to tame the resurrection. I can explain it, but I don't want to tame it. Easter is not a matter of our questioning the resurrection. It's allowing the resurrection to question us. See, it's not about what am I going to do this morning. Do I got to try and whip you up into a frenzy because it's the resurrection? It's not about that at all. It's about how does the resurrection question you? And the real question is this, I want to put out there this morning, what would it take, or what does it take, to make a change in your life? What does it take to change something? I got a text during the week that I thought was going to change my life. I'll read it to you. Your mobile number has been selected as a winner of £6.5 million. Click on this link to claim. I thought, this could change my life.
Not in a good way.
You cynics. Are you telling me that's a fake?
Yes.
Do you know what I did? I got out my phone and I converted it to dollars. That £6.5 million is $11.869 million. I said, Lord, if this is true, I'll give $5 million to Gateway. Let it be true. And Lord, I'll keep the rest. But it would change my life. It would change my family. It would change my future. You know, after a while, I started to get mad because I knew it was fake. And I started to think, I've been robbed of $11.865 million because you're telling me it's a fake and you won't let me open the link, will you? If you'd said yes, I would have done it after church. See, here's my problem. I know that not only do those people not want to give me $11.865 million, they want to siphon out every dollar that I've got. Listen, folks, can I say this in any possible way I can? Today, we do not preach the resurrection or proclaim the resurrection as a cruel hoax. If you just rolled into church this morning and you're going, just whatever, go to, not many people are doing it these days, but I'll go to church at Easter time, this is not a hoax. And I'm not even going to prove why, I'm just going to proclaim it. I'm just going to tell you, he's risen. And he's changed our world, and he's changing lives. And it's not through explanations, it's because he's alive. It's because he's risen. You know, there's a scripture that says this, for what I received, this is the Apostle Paul, I love this, I've passed on to you as, say it with me, first importance that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried and was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And then he goes on to talk about how the risen Christ appeared to Peter and the disciples and about 500 others. And then Paul says, and last of all, he appeared to, anybody know? Me. If Paul were here today, he would take this opportunity to say, you know what? I'm not going to try and prove that he rose. I'm just going to proclaim it. How do I know it? Because I saw him. I know him, the resurrected Christ. About 10 years ago, I was in Jerusalem on my own. I was going to meet Lynn in Egypt. That's how modern people travel these days, isn't it? See you, honey. I'm off to Jerusalem. I'll meet you in Cairo. That's kind of the way it works. But I was in there in Jerusalem, and it was 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and I was sitting in the lounge of the hotel I was staying, and I saw a man sitting on his own, and I thought I'd just say g'day. So I went over and said, g'day, my name's Neil. He told me his name, told me he was a doctor, a Jew, and he lived in Paris. I said, wow, good to meet you. I said, what are you doing here? Just on holiday? He said, no, I bring my father here. He's about 85, and I bring him here twice a year. He said he comes over here twice a year to speak to children and young people about his experiences when he was in Auschwitz. He was taken there as a 16-year-old with his parents, who he never saw after the day they went into the camp, never saw them again. And then out of the blue, this man said to me, he said, do you want to talk to him? I said, do I want to talk to him? I said, if I get with him, he may never get to bed tonight. This man went and got his father, and I sat down there with the three of them. And for 3 hours, I asked this man questions. I asked him every question that would come to my head. I wanted to know who, why, where, how, what. How did a 16-year-old boy cope when within weeks he knew what was going on and there was no hope and no future for him or his parents? And when we got to the end of that 3 hours and I could see that he was starting to get a bit weary, I thought I'd better let this man go. I said to him, do you mind if I ask one last question? I said, there are people today who think that it didn't happen. There are people today who think this is just a hoax. I said, what would you say to people like that? He sat there for about 20 seconds and I thought, I've upset him. And he looked at me, and folks, to this day, I've never seen a look in a man's eyes like it. There was a steely, unflinching, and yet warm look in those eyes. And he finally said to me, I just tell them that I was there. I just tell them I was there. You know, my suspicion as a church, and I've been around church a few years now, my suspicion is that we've tried too hard to convince the world about Jesus and his resurrection. See, here was a man who lived what other people just talked about. He was a man whose life had been irrevocably changed because of Auschwitz. And if you ask me today, how on earth are we going to convince a cynical world about Jesus Christ? Folks, we've got to stop trying so hard to convince them, and our world need to see some Christians who've been to the empty tomb. We need to allow them to see some Christians who have been changed because of the resurrection. We need people to meet some blind people who can say, you know what, all I can tell you was, once I was blind, but now I can see. We need to introduce them to some tax collectors who, after he'd been so transformed by Jesus, he said, you know what, I'm going to give half my money to the poor, and if I've stolen from anybody, he said, I'm going to repay them four times more. How about that? By the way, can I just digress for a minute? Folks, repentance is not just an apology. You're going to wonder where I'm going with this. I didn't even plan to say this. Repentance is not just a lazy sorry, I've done something. We have cheapened repentance by making repentance as something that doesn't cost us anything. You know what I'm saying? Lord, I'm sorry. And God says, really? What did that cost you? How is that going to change you? What is that going to make a difference? What is that now going to take away from your life? Who do you got to give back to? What are you going to change? See, our world needs to see some people that live the resurrection and not just talk about it. Well, you know what? The Bible says this, and I'm just going to put this verse up here. I love this. He says, since we've now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, listen to this, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Don't you love that? Like, you think of the benefits of the cross for eternity. And Paul lets his mind go. He says, man, I can't even tame this. I can't even explain this. He said, if his death brings all those benefits, how much more will his life benefit us? You know, I think I probably should stop here for a minute. You know what happens when I'm preaching every now and then? I get the feeling sometimes you're so busy preaching the power of the gospel, in this case, the power of the resurrection, and you're sitting there thinking, you know what? There is such a chasm between what he's saying and where I am. If he only knew where I was right now, and in fact, hearing about the power of the resurrection is killing me. It's not giving me life because somehow there's such a great gap between the two. Folks, I'm aware of that. I don't want fake Christianity, do you? I don't want you putting on a righteousness that you haven't got. I don't want you trying to look better than you really are. Some of you might be really struggling to live out the resurrection this morning. You know, you're a bit of like a budgie that I read about once. I love this little story. His name was Chippy. And Chippy never knew what hit him. One minute he was singing away on his perch and then it all happened. Chippy's owner decided to clean his cage with a vacuum cleaner. She removed the attachment from one end of the hose and stuck it in the cage. And just then the phone rang and she turned to answer the phone. And all of a sudden there's a... and Chippy was gone. The lady screamed, dropped the phone, ripped open the vacuum cleaner, tipped out the bag, and there was Chippy, still alive, but stunned. He's covered with dust and grime, and so she grabbed him and raced in the bathroom, and she turned on the tap, and she held him under the tap to get rid of all the dust and grime. And then realising Chippy was now soaked and shivering, she did what any compassionate bird lover would do. She got out the hairdryer, and she blasted him with hot air. Poor old Chippy didn't know what hit him. A couple of days later, one of the neighbours came in and said, how's Chippy? And the lady said, Chippy doesn't sing so much anymore. He just sits and stares. Folks, I want to say this quite openly. I spend a lot of my time with Christians who feel like they've been sucked in, washed out, and blown away. And they just stare. That's why it's so important to me this morning. Like, what do we do with the resurrection? God, do you know how I want that message to be powerful, but at the moment, you don't know where I'm at. You got to know, I've been sucked in, I've been washed out, I've been blown away. Life has just dealt me some of this most terrible and tragic stuff. What do you want me to do with the resurrection? I'm struggling just to survive. Folks, I want to proclaim the resurrection. I don't know any other way. I want you to go to Romans 8, and I promise you we won't be here all morning. I want to spend about 10 minutes in Romans 8, and I just want to share with you an untamed benefit of the resurrection. I can't explain all these things, but I want to tell you about it. Go to Romans chapter 8, and let's have a look at these verses. The very first thing that God offers us because of Jesus' life is grace. Okay, grace. Have a look at Romans chapter 8 and verse 1 and 2. Listen to this. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Folks, never get used to that. Okay? No condemnation. None. You see, maybe you've got to be like me. I was a very naughty little boy. You can't believe that, can you? I just look so saintly these days. No condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Listen to this. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. Folks, whenever you hear about law, it's always bad news, right? Whenever I had a run-in with the law, it didn't end well for me. Because law is about punishment. Folks, there's a new law. How about that? Finally, a law that outdoes the law of sin and death. And it's the law of, say it with me, life. Life in the Spirit. Life in the risen Christ. That's grace. That is grace. You know what? Paul could have easily written this and said, there's now no condemnation to those who deserve condemnation. He doesn't. He just says there's no condemnation. I can explain that, but I don't want to tame it. What does it mean? I'll tell you what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean, man, there's no condemnation. God's grace is upon me. I can do whatever I like. Folks, is that how you treat someone who loves you? Imagine if Lynn said to me lunchtime, what was that thing? I have deep affection for you or whatever it is. I said, thanks, honey. I can now do what I like. Wouldn't it draw me to her? I mean, Lynn's a nurse. They don't speak like that. They do things. And when someone does something for you, you are drawn to them. And I think Paul got it right when he met Jesus and said, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? That's grace. But you know what it means? It means that we're never going to fear condemnation. I can't get that out of my head. I don't fear condemnation. Do you know what's the thing I fear most of all? I've had to think about this. Dancing. Come on, is there anybody else with me? Thank you. Andrew, come up here. Let's have a dance. You know what? If I didn't fear condemnation about dancing, because when I dance, you know what people do? Yeah, they laugh. And they go, look at him. He can't dance. Do you know, if I didn't feel that, I'd probably dance now. Do you understand the detrimental effect of condemnation? It just shuts you down. Man, I don't know how to get this message across. It's rained today. You know what there's going to be outside? Maybe it'll be evaporated by the time we get there, but there'll be some puddles of water. Do you know what I used to love doing when I was a kid? You'd come to a puddle of water. What would you do? You'd just jump in the puddle of water. What happened? Yeah, you get wet, but Mum got mad. And she's not going to wash those clothes. You got mud all up and down your legs. And so that kind of condemnation got to a point where I grew up and now I walk around puddles of water. Do you know what? Since I've had my midlife crisis, which started at about 21 and it hasn't finished, I don't walk around puddles anymore. Folks, today, if you see a puddle, I want you to jump in the puddle, all right? Straight in the middle of it. And if somebody says, what are you doing that for? You tell them, Jesus has risen from the dead. And they'll go, you're nuts. I go, yep. But there's no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. How good is that? Oh, I don't know any other way to put it. What have you stopped doing because you fear condemnation? We're down the beach this morning, and I'm thinking, man, I'm going to be sharing with these people. What if a couple of hipsters come along? Man. And then I thought, talk louder so they can hear. I'm not afraid of a couple of hipsters. Let the whole beach come. Because you know what? There's no condemnation. And if God doesn't condemn me, what do I care about a couple of hipsters if they do? Man, I tell you, it sets you free. It sets you free. The second thing that is a gift, untamed love, is in verse 14. I better put some verses up here. It's identity. identity. You know, it's important to me who I am. Is it important to you who you are? Have a look at this, verse 14. It says, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are what? God's children. Now, if we are children, then we're heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings. And we cut that bit out of the Bible. I'm not sure why that's not there, but it talks about being heirs. Heirs. You know, I love being an heir. I love it. I love being somebody's son. You know, my grandfather was a politician in Canberra during 1950 to 1959. And when I was 18, all I wanted to do was to go and sit in the upper house seat where my grandfather sat for 9 years. So I went there with my brother. And when we got there, this is in the old Parliament House, and I'm walking down the corridors, and I just loved it. Everything in me was saying, this is where I need to be. This is what I want to be when I grow up. And there might have been a couple of doors that said no admittance, but that couldn't stop me. I thought, I'm home. And so I went through those doors. And finally, a man came up to me and he said, what do you think you're doing here? Who are you? And I was nearly going to say, I'm Neil Ryan. Instead, I said, I'm John Victor Ryan's grandson. Do you know what he said? He said, I work with John. Very fine man. He said, come with me. I said, I'm ready. He took me into the Prime Minister's office. The Prime Minister wasn't there. And he sat me down in the seat of the Prime Minister's office. And I thought, finally. It's taken me a whole 18 years to get here. This is where I belong. He said, come, let me show you around. We went through every door that said members only. He said, come with me and we'll go to the members' dining hall. He said, have you got any relatives in London? I said, no. He said, well, I was going to let you ring them. I thought, that's where all our taxes are going. Young blokes ringing London at Parliament House. You know, it was all about who I belonged to. I say this because you and I are living in a day when people are trying to shut us down. Folks, don't run away from that. Our world is saying you don't belong here anymore, like Christians have had their day. Just fade off the scene, will you? Can I put to you this morning, let Jesus take you where he wants you to go. Let him grab your hand like that man grabbed my hand and said, this is a place where you belong. Let me take you where I want you to go. Because Jesus said, unashamedly, you are the light of the world. You are the, what else? Salt of the earth. Folks, let Jesus shine where he wants to shine. You can't put light under a jar. And God won't have that. I remember being in India a few years ago and I spoke to a doctor over there and he called me a donkey. And I said, how did you know me so well, so quickly? He said, no, brother. He said, I reserved that for my dearest friends. Well, I don't want to know what you call your enemies. And he said, no, no, brother. He said, there's nothing like being a donkey for Jesus. I thought, this is getting worse. Where's he going with this? He said, Neil, when Jesus needed to come into Jerusalem to go to the cross, he said to his disciples, go and you'll find a donkey. Bring him to me. And I'll ride on that donkey into Jerusalem. This doctor said to me, do you ever get excited about being a donkey for Jesus? I said, man, I do now. Everywhere I go, I'm going to call people donkeys. Do you understand what I'm getting at? Folks, don't try and force it. Don't go into the world and say, I've got a right to be, you know, obnoxious to you because I believe in Christ and you don't. Folks, let Jesus take you in there. Let him make you the salt of the earth and the light of the world, and let him come in on you to benefit the lives of people with your truth and with your grace and with your honesty and just in what you can proclaim. Man, there's nothing like it. All right, we better finish. The last thing that we've got here, I don't know why these all come up number one. They should have been one, two, three, but that doesn't matter. The untamed truth of the resurrection is we have a new motivation, a brand new motivation. Right at the end of Romans chapter 8, it says this: if God is for us, who can be against us? The only thing that bothers me is that little word if. Sounds a bit dodgy, doesn't it? Well, when you've studied Greek like I have, I've got a friend who owns a fish and chip shop, you'll know that that word doesn't mean if, it means since. How about that? Since Christ is for us, who can be against us? What a statement. By the way, does that mean that we have some kind of advantage over others in terms of what happens? Fire sweeps through the street, but our house is spared. A flu epidemic runs through the office, but I miss out. A drunken driver takes to the road, but he won't hit my car. Sadly, it's none of that. I can remember years ago, I think it was back in the early 2000s, Pat Rafter was playing Goran Ivanišević in a Wimbledon final. It went to five sets. It was 8-7 in the fifth set and deuce. It went to deuce a number of times, and if Pat lost the game, he lost the match. And right at that crucial point, Ivanišević picked up the ball and he pointed towards heaven and he crossed himself. And I'm sitting there watching this thinking, oh no! No! Now Pat Rafter's not only playing against Ivanišević, he's playing against God. And to make it worse, Ivanišević won. You know, that's the way a lot of people see Christianity. I've got God, I cross myself, I do what I got to do, and God shows me favours and he does things for me he won't do for anybody else, folks. That's not a motivation to live. You will get disappointed. You will. Now, do I believe God does far abundantly above all that I could ask or think? Thank goodness it is. But did you get the message? It's above all that I could ask or think. Not above all that I can scheme and try and make happen. So whenever God blesses me in a way that surprises me, I go, wow, where'd that come from? Listen, God is not a cosmic genie who comes out of the bottle and grants our every wish. He's a God who loves us enough that he can change us. That's where I started the message. What does it take to change you? Well, grace, identity, and a new motivation. You know, all I'm going to do is read. I'm going to finish with these words here are paraphrased of the last verses in Romans where Paul talks about if God is for me, who can be against me? And there's nothing that can separate me from the love of God. I want you to, this was written by a lady called Ruth Harms Kalkin, and she wrote this: God, I may fall flat on my face, I may fail until I feel old and beaten and done in, yet your love for me is changeless. All the music may go out of my life, my private world may shatter to dust. Even so, you will hold me in the palm of your steady hand. No turn in the affairs of my fractured life can baffle you. Satan, with all of his bragging, cannot distract you. Nothing can separate me from your measureless love. Pain can't, disappointment can't, anguish can't. Yesterday, today, tomorrow can't. The loss of my dearest love can't. Death can't, life can't, riots, wars, insanity, unidentity, hunger, neurosis, disease. None of these things, or all of them heaped together, can budge the fact that I am dearly loved, completely forgiven, and forever free through Jesus Christ, your beloved Son. Wow. That's the resurrection. Untamed. You tell me this morning if any one of you don't fit into that passage. Is there? Folks, I proclaim the resurrection. He's alive. You want me to tell you how he's going to fix it? Wouldn't even begin. But I present to you Christ, crucified, buried, and risen again. And one who comes and says, don't tame me. You don't know how I can change you. Just let me. Open up your heart. And I'll come in. I'm going to ask the musos to come. And I'd love them just to, I don't know if this is a difficult thing, but just play a little bit. I just love you to meditate. I don't want any words. What was that question? Not a time to question the resurrection, but a time to let the resurrection question us. Lord, where have I become unchangeable? That's a place of death. We need life. I don't care how messy it is or how difficult or how many times you've tried before. Today we proclaim the risen Christ. Just bow our heads. Let's just listen. Let's allow the Holy Spirit to put his finger wherever he needs to place it and say, I can come in there. I can bring grace. I can give you a new identity at that very point. And I can give you a new motivation to trust me. Let's pray. Father, we stand with generations of people who have been transformed by the message of the risen Christ. I pray this morning that the risen Christ might stand as King of Kings, as Lord of Lords, as the one whose name is above every name, and that at that name, the name of Jesus Christ our Saviour, we would bow our knee and our heart and allow the risen Christ to come in. We give you our lives afresh this morning and we bless you in Jesus' name.